Hello students, welcome to a lesson through the virtual training center of the Brihan Mumbai Mahanagarpalika. My name is Shraddha teacher, and in this lockdown period, since we are not able to go to school children, we will be doing many lessons here online through the virtual class. So come on, let's proceed to our lesson for today.
Now if you remember children, we were doing a lesson in English, that is we were talking about the lesson called the necklace last time, and we did the first half of the story, isn't it? We talked about the person who has written this story, that is a French man called as Guy de Maupassant. We talked about the various characters in the story, that is we talked about Monsieur Loisel, we talked about Madame Loisel and her friend Madame Forestier, and what all happened in the first part of the story. We saw that Madame Loisel, or Mathilde as she is called in this particular story, is a lady who is very interested in showing off that she's got a lot of wealth, she's got a lot of property, and she's never happy with her circumstances. She always keeps cursing her husband, and she's not happy that she doesn't have a lot of money, and she wants to prove to society that she owns a lot of jewelry, a lot of good clothes, alright? And for that reason, when she is invited to a ball, she borrows this particular necklace, which seems to be very expensive, alright, and she wears it. And in the last half of the story, we saw last time that unfortunately she loses the necklace. The necklace falls off her neck somewhere. So that was part one of the story. Now let's move on and let's see what happens in part two of the story this time. So here we will see, continuing with the story, we will see that Mathilde is all worried, she's all worked up, okay? She's lost the precious necklace that she borrowed from her friend Madame Forestier, and she knows that she does not have any money to buy another necklace for her, and she will have to somehow or the other return Madame Forestier's necklace. So she starts searching for the necklace high and low. Her husband and she, they start searching for the necklace everywhere possible. The first place they go to is the police station. So, Monsieur Loisel, he goes to the police station and he tries to lodge a complaint that they have lost this kind of a necklace, and if someone finds it, they can return it back to them. After the police station, he even goes to a newspaper office. You know now, when sometimes people lose certain things, or when a person gets lost, what do the relatives do? They put up an ad in the newspaper, an advertisement in the newspaper, saying that if someone finds this person loitering around, or if they find the object, they can return it to its owner and can they can claim a reward, isn't it? So newspaper office is what they do. When you go and give this kind of a request that I have lost a necklace and if someone returns it, I will give them a small reward. So the newspaper office will publish it in their newspaper the next day. Okay, so our person in the story, that is a character in the story, Monsieur Loisel. Now, Monsieur, children, is a way of saying Mr. in French. It is a title in French. It is M-O-N-S-I-E-U-R. We say Monsieur Loisel. And for the lady, we say Madame or Madame Loisel. Okay, so our story, the hero in our story, Monsieur Loisel, he goes to the police station. He goes to the newspaper office and he tries to lodge a complaint, or in any way he is desperate now to get the necklace back. Why? Because the necklace doesn't belong to him. It belongs to someone else. He has just borrowed it and now he needs to return it, isn't it? He also goes and checks with all the taxi drivers in the town because they had taken a taxi back home. So he goes and searches in all the taxis also. But unfortunately, he is not able to find the necklace anywhere. But his wife has to return the necklace to her friend. So what they do now is, they start thinking and then they finally decide that somehow the necklace has to be returned. And therefore they go to a shop and they try to find a necklace which is similar to the one that they have lost. Fortunately for them, they find one piece which is very similar the necklace that this lady has lost, Mathilde. Okay? But when they ask about the cost of the necklace, they get a big shock because the necklace costs 40,000 francs. Now, like we say rupees in India, we say dollars in America, you say francs in French. Okay, it is the French currency, francs. So the cost of the necklace, they say, is 40,000 francs. But the shopkeeper agrees to sell it for 36,000 francs. Now remember, children, 36,000 francs is a big amount. Okay, and for someone who doesn't have too much money, like Monsieur Loisel and Madame Loisel, it is actually a bigger burden. How will they get so much money from? From where will they bring all this money? Somehow or the other, they take loan from a bank, they take loan from people who give money on interest, and they sell away their property. So in a way, you can say, in order to return the necklace, they destroy themselves. All right? And finally, after so much of trouble, after so much of, you can say, they become zero themselves. Now they do not have any property with them. They do not have any bank account, bank balance with them. They have taken a lot of loan and now they do not know how to return it. They will have to work very hard. They will have to change their entire lifestyle. Okay? All this was for what? For a necklace which she has worn just to show off that she's got a lot of money. So they collect this 36,000 francs somehow. They buy this particular necklace, and Madame Mathilde or Madame Loisel, she goes and she returns it to Madame Forestier. Now the real trouble in their life starts from now. They lead a very, very difficult life after that. They do not have enough to eat, all right? They have to continuously borrow money and then return the money. Madame Loisel has to work in people's houses. Okay, she has to do all kinds of menial jobs and they have to live a life of utter poverty. Why all this? Remember, we are always going back to the point that borrowing this necklace was of no use. It had no end actually. She could have just worn what she had and she could have gone out to the party. No one would have questioned her. No one would have judged her. So children, sometimes most of the things that we do just to show others, okay, just to impress others, lead to a lot of trouble in our life. In Hindi they say, apni jitni chadar ho, utni hi humko pair phailana chahiye. That means we should never try to live beyond our means. If you have a friend who's very rich and his lifestyle is very good, you should not look at that person and start feeling jealous and start living like him because he's got that money and you don't have. Okay? So this is a very big moral that we can take away from this particular lesson. So moving on with the story, you will see that, look at this picture of Madame Loisel here, or Mathilde as we call her in the story. You can see that she looks like an old woman now. She was very young, but later on, in quite a few years, she looks like a very, very old woman because life has been very, very unfair to her. Okay? Now time passes and the ladies, they don't meet each other. Mathilde and Madame Forestier, they have not met each other for a long time now after returning the necklace. Madame Forestier is rich and she continues with her life, whereas Mathilde, poor thing, she is suffering and suffering just because of that one necklace. Alright, and she is cursing herself. She curses herself day in and day out for simply trying to make a show of things and borrowing the necklace. One day, after a long time, suddenly out of the blue, one fine day, Madame Loisel and Madame Forestier happen to meet each other. Now see, they are both friends, okay? They have studied together in school. But look at how they look different, isn't it? See, the one on the left is Mathilde and the one on the right is Madame Forestier. See how young, youthful, beautiful Madame Forestier looks. And look at our poor Mathilde. See how her condition is. She looks like an old, haggard woman, isn't it? And Madame Forestier is shocked. She asks her friend Mathilde, how come you've become like this? What is wrong with you? Are you sick? Are you in some kind of trouble? And that is the time when Mathilde narrates the story of the necklace and the repayment that they have been making for the 36,000 francs. Now comes the twist in the story, children. When she tells, Mathilde tells, Madame Forestier, my life has been horrible because of that necklace I borrowed 10 years ago. Can you imagine what reply Madame Forestier gives to Mathilde? She says, oh my God, my friend, that necklace was false. False in the sense, it was not even a necklace made up of real diamonds. It was a false necklace. But both of them, this lady, she hid from her friend, Madame Forestier, when she gave the necklace to Mathilde, she should have told her that this is not a very expensive necklace. It only looks like that. It is a false necklace. And even Mathilde, she did not bother to tell her friend the truth. She should have gone up and should have told her friend, you see, I have lost your necklace. I will return it to you at any cost. That time her friend would have surely told her that, madam, it is not a real one. It is a fake one. But they kept things hidden from each other. This is the second moral that we can take away from the story. Be frank, be open, be truthful about things. It will take you, it will save you a lot of trouble in life. Okay? So these things we learn from the story, and we see how false pride leads to a fall, how being untruthful, how hiding things from people who are close to us can also land you in a lot of trouble in life. So that was the story, children, of the necklace or the diamond necklace, which is written by Guy de Maupassant. Okay? Now, as we do each time, we look at a little bit of grammar point from our textbook. So in the grammar point today, we will look at certain points later. In the beginning now, let us look at the written skill development part in our textbook, writing skill, that is writing an invitation letter. So you have this invitation letter in your textbook where they are asking you to write an invitation. Before that, let us look at this particular, you can say, model or you can say specimen of an invitation. So this is an invitation written by the management of a school, and it is being given out because of the annual day function. So the school management wants people means people connected to the school, the children, the parents, etc., to attend the annual day function. So let us just read how an invitation will look like. Okay, so the management, the principal, staff and students of Navodaya Public School, Ajmer, request your benevolent presence on the auspicious occasion of the annual function of their school. Now, when is the annual function? It is at 10 a.m. on September the 12th. And they are saying that there is a very important person who will preside over the function, and he will distribute the prizes to the winners. And this invitation is being sent out by the principal of Navodaya Public School, Ajmer. Now, remember, this is an official invitation, children. So, when there is a annual function in the school, it will be conducted in the school itself. If the school decides to do it elsewhere, they will inform the people who have been invited. So that is the reason that the venue is not written over here. Now you have a small exercise based on this invitation in your textbook also. Let us look at that particular exercise. Here we are going to do some fill in the blanks. But before that, let us highlight what is there in this particular invitation. So this invitation is being sent out by a couple, Mr. and Mrs. Okay? So you can write any name that you want over here. You can write your own name. You can write my name. You can write your friend's name. So I have chosen the name Mr. and Mrs. Sharma here. So Mr. and Mrs. Sharma, they solicit the pleasure of your company on the occasion of the, so why are they inviting you? So the occasion is the birthday of their son. Alright, so can you change the occasion? You can change the occasion to anything that you want. You can say naming ceremony, you can say opening of the house, inauguration of the house, anything that you desire or you feel good or the situation demands. According to your situation, you can change the words over here. So these people, Mr. and Mrs. Sharma, they are inviting someone to the birthday of their son. It is important to tell the date and the day. So it is on Friday and the date is the 16th of August. Now one very important thing here is, children, the venue. Venue means where will the birthday function take place. So it will be at Pearl Hall and the timing is also extremely important. So the timing is 6 a.m. So whatever you see here on the screen in red color, these are the things which are very, very essential if you are inviting someone. So you need to put out the name of the person who's inviting, the occasion for which you're inviting someone, the day, the date, the place and the time. The remaining part of the invitation, you can use words according to your vocabulary. Alright, let us check, go back to our previous invitation and let us check whether all these elements are common. Yes, so we have the person who's inviting, we have what the invitation is for, we have the day, the date, the timing, okay, and venue is of course the school. Okay, children, so this was one language skill, you can say a part or portion in your textbook in this particular lesson about writing an invitation. You have an invitation to a ball as an instance in this particular lesson, isn't it? So they are invited to a ball. And I told you the last time, ball means a party actually. And that is the reason this entire story starts, isn't it? They're invited to a ball, so she, Mathilde, goes to borrow the necklace. So this was the invitation part. Now let us quickly, we have a few minutes left into the lesson. Let us quickly look at some grammar portion now, without which our lesson is always incomplete. So we will look at determiners today in English. So what are determiners, children? They play a very important role in English grammar. Determiners are nothing but words which precede a noun. Precede means it comes before a noun. Okay? So a word which comes before a noun and it is used to express the reference of the noun. For example, I say this book, this. So I want to say it is this book, not that book. Alright, so this word will be the determiner here. It is used to modify the meaning of a noun. So see, when I am saying this book, I mean the one which is lying close to me, not the one which is lying far away from me. If I want to talk about the book which is lying far away from me, I would say that book. So it is modifying the meaning of the noun, the book. Isn't it? If you do not understand these grammar points, children, grammar is a very difficult topic to talk about and understand in English. If you do not understand grammar in this format, which is not interactive, you can do one thing. You can rewind the video and you can watch it again. Rewind the video n number of times and you can watch it again till you understand. Okay? So, let us look at an easy meaning now. You are in the 9th standard, so we discussed a difficult meaning of determiner. To make it easy for you, a determiner is a word that introduces a noun. For example, if you go to your school with your brother, to your teacher, what do you say? This is my brother. My brother, not someone else's. Okay, so my there is a determiner. So determiners are words that introduce a noun and provide some information about it. Just some information, okay? For example, see, the balls. The now here is the definite article. We have learnt about articles, isn't it? A, an and the. So the here is the definite article. His son. Not my son, not your son. His son. Five cats. So five here is a quantifier. You can also say that five is an adjective. More cars. So more is a quantifier. Okay. So these are all determiners which we use in English. Let us look at some more examples. So determiners could be articles. They could be demonstrators or demonstrative pronouns. They could be possessive adjectives. They could be quantifiers, numbers or ordinals. Okay, so this is all the time that we have, children. Now quickly, this is the last exercise in your textbook based on determiners. So look at the examples here. We already explained, I already told you what the meaning of determiners are. Let us look at these examples here. So the necklace, the is a determiner. An error, so an is a determiner. All these things, so all these is a determiner. Another woman, another is a determiner. One evening, so one is a determiner. Her husband, her is the determiner. Alright, so no need to tell you again. The determiners are what? They are words which precede the noun and which tell us or specify more about the noun that we are talking about. Now in that particular lesson, the necklace, we have a grammar point, that is verb and its forms, which is actually a very, very important part of learning English grammar. Now when you have to speak English properly, or when you have to write English properly, or when you have to use English correctly, that you have to pay a lot of attention to how you're using the verb in its proper tenses. So we will look at this particular exercise from your textbook itself. All right. So in this particular exercise, they have asked you to learn more about the verb in the base form, the verb in the S form, the past tense of verbs, the present participle tense of verbs, and the past participle tense of verbs. So this is a long lesson. There are many things that we have to learn here, and most of these things sometimes are a little confusing also. But what we will try and do is we will pick up each of these points. That is, we will first see what is the base form of a verb, how do you make the S form of a verb, how do you deal with the past tense of a verb, what is the past tense of a verb, what is the meaning of the present participle and the past participle of verbs. Okay, so we'll try and make it as easy as possible using easy terms and also using easy and simple examples. So let us start at the beginning and let us try and understand the meaning of the base form of a verb. So what is the base form of a verb? The form of a verb without any endings is called as the base form of a verb. You will see an example of the base form here. P-L-A-Y, play. Okay, so this base form of a verb is the version of the verb that you will find in a dictionary. So when you're searching for a verb in a dictionary, you will not find playing, or you will not find played in the dictionary originally. What will you find? You will find the word play, and then you will see the various versions of it. Okay, so what is the base form once again? The base form of a verb is a verb without any endings. Now this is the most commonly used form in the simple present or in the form of an instruction. So what is the base form of the verb? It is the first form of the verb, and it is most commonly used either in the simple present tense when you want to talk about something which is happening now, simple present tense, or in the imperative form. Imperative form means when we learned types of sentences, we learned a type of sentence called as imperative sentence. So imperative sentence meant what? When you're giving an order to someone. Okay, when you're giving an instruction to someone. So the base form of the verb, where will you find it? You will find it either when the verb is appearing in the simple present tense, or the verb is an instructional form or an imperative form. Let us look at some examples here. So see, I eat mangoes. Simple present, eat. So if you go through the dictionary, if you turn around the pages in the dictionary, you will find eat under the section E. Okay? Then the next example, I go there. So go is again an example of a verb in the base form. This go, when you change it, when you add some things to it, then you make it going, okay, or you make it gone, or you make it goes, but that is a different form. This is the base form. I work for a company. Simple present. Work. I work for a company. That means at present, I work for a company. They go there every day. Again, a simple present. Okay? So these base forms of verbs are used in simple present tenses. And like I told you, in the imperative form. So see, in the imperative form, be quiet. You're instructing someone not to say anything. You're telling them to be quiet. Have a nice day. So have a nice day is not in a way, you know, forcing someone to have a nice day, but it is a kind of a wish that you're making for someone. Have a nice day. Now the next one is a request or is an instruction. Make a chapati. So these are all the base forms of the verb. So that is our first point down. We were supposed to talk about base form of the verb. Let's move on and see the next point there, the S form of the verb. So this is the form of the verb used to form the third person singular in the present tense. Third person singular is he, she, or it. Okay, that is the third person singular. In English, this is the most commonly formed by simply adding S or ES. Alright, so the S form of the verb is used in the third person singular in the present tense. And it is formed by adding S or by adding ES. There are some, you can say, exceptions also. Like for example, see, have, it becomes has. Okay, so that is a little change. Then you have do, which takes ES and becomes does, and implies, which drops the Y and takes an IES. So there are some exceptions also, but usually it is formed by adding an S or by adding an ES. For example, walk becomes walks. Okay, we will look at some examples now. So hope you understood what is the S form of the verb. So the S form of the verb is you go one step ahead of the base form when you want to talk about a third person singular, and in the present tense you make it or it is formed by adding the S or the ES, and there are some irregular examples also. Let us look at some examples here. So see, help becomes helps. Now the second one is a little different. Carry, you have the Y, you drop it and it becomes carries. Okay, clutch, you add ES, clutches. Cut becomes cuts. Bring becomes brings. Run becomes runs. Fall becomes falls. And drink become drinks. So most of them, except for the carry, is in the regular form. It takes the S or it takes the ES. Some more example. See, listen becomes listens. Promise becomes promises. Say becomes says. Learn becomes learns. Change becomes changes. And finishes finishes. Okay? So this is the S form of the verb. When is it used? It is used in the third person singular present tense. I will show you an example. I will show you one more image where there are some examples so you will understand better. See, this is the simple present tense, and now we are looking at our example of the S. So he listens. I told you, third person singular is he, she, or it. So I listen, you listen. There is no need to take the S. There is no need to add the S form. But when you're talking about he, then you say he listens to music. She listens to music. It listens to music. Okay? So this is the third person singular. Alright? So in these cases, the verb with the base form, it takes an S or it adds an ES. So that is second point down. We talked about what is the base form and we talked about the S form. Let us look at the next that we have learned about the past tense of verbs. So what is the simple meaning of past tense? Past tense means something that has happened in the past, something that has already happened, an event which has taken place. So see here, we are here in the present. The future is something which we do not know, which will not happen now, which will happen after now. Whereas the past is something which has happened before now. So it is something which has already happened. So see some examples here. Wave is waved, jumped, walked, hopped, liked, watched, talked. So I think this is very easy for you to understand the simple past tense because you are in the 9th standard and we have been learning this before now also. So let's look at some examples of past tense. So a past tense tells us about an action that happened in the past. Most of the past tenses are formed by adding ed to the verb. So you have walk and walked, play and played, you have look and looked, smile, smiled, call, called, open, opened. So these are some simple examples or some regular examples of past tenses. Some more examples. Now some past tense are irregular and sometimes the verb changes. For example, give becomes gave. Okay, run becomes ran. Run, give doesn't become gived, or run doesn't become runned. Have becomes had. See becomes saw. I've heard many people saying I seed it yesterday. That is wrong English. Okay, it is see is saw. Hold becomes held and get becomes got. So little irregular. Not using the rule of adding ed. So that is why it is irregular. Moving on, let's look at some past tenses which do not change at all. So see, hit will remain hit. So you will not say I hitted him yesterday or I hit him yesterday. You will say I hit him. I hit him today, I hit him yesterday. Alright? Then you have put. Put will not be putted. Or put will not be pat. Okay? Put will still remain put in the past tense. Shut will also remain shut in the past tense. There are many more examples, children. So one small this assignment I will give you in the middle of the lesson. After you finish watching this video, you can pick up the dictionary, find out at least 10 base verbs and then find out the past tense of these base verbs. Okay, so that is an assignment as we go along. Let us move on and let us look at some more examples here so that the idea is clear to you. So first we will look at the regular ones and then we will look at the irregular ones, or we look at all of them together. It's a mixed, you can say, bag. So help is helped, carry is carried, clutch is clutched, cut is cut. See, it is not changing. Okay, bring has changed altogether, it has become brought. Run has also changed, ran, fall has changed to fell, and drink has changed to drank. So you can see a mixed bag of past tense forms, mixed examples, where the first one is regular, the second one, wherever there is a Y, we drop the Y and we add a ED. And then you have clutch, clutched, and the others. Some more examples. See here, these are all irregular. Okay, in the first list, we had a few regular ones and some of the others were not regular. Here, these are all irregular. So eat becomes ate, fall becomes fell, feel becomes felt, fight becomes fought, find becomes found, fly becomes flew, and forget becomes forgot. Okay, so this is the third point in our lesson. We are talking about past tense forms of the verbs. Moving on to the next point, have two more points going, children. The meaning of present participle and the past participle. So the present participle means a verb which ends with an ing. Okay? And when the present participle is used in the verb, it shows continuing actions. And it always follows a helping verb. It is also called as present progressive. Okay? So something which is happening, which is not finished happening, but which is in the process of happening. So one more definition. The present participle is a type of verb that describes an action that is occurring during the current time. So an action which is happening at present. When a verb is used to describe that kind of an action, then we call it as the present participle form of the verb. Now, children, there are some other points also connected with this. Sometimes verbs with the ing form, it could be the gerund or it could also be the adjective, but we are not looking at that point here now. We are looking at present participle form of a verb used in the present progressive tense. Okay, let us look at examples now here. So see, cook is cooking, laugh is laughing, cry is crying, walk is walking, think thinking, sing singing, eat eating, and drink drinking. So simple, when you're using a verb in a sentence which shows the present progressive tense, that is an action is happening in the present but it is continuing, it will continue for some time maybe, then that is called as the present participle use or form of the verb. Okay? So now we come to the last point in our grammar lesson today, for today, the past participle form. So like we have the present participle talking about the present, the past participle will talk about the past or the perfect tense. Past participle forms of verbs are used in the perfect tense also. So let us try and understand what it is. The form of a verb usually made by adding ed. So how is this verb formed? By adding ed, and it is used in some grammatical structures such as passive or in the present perfect tense. So see, cook is cooked. Okay, so this could be the past participle or this could be the simple past also. I will show you examples to differentiate the two so you understand what is the past participle form better. So alright, so see, past participle. What is past participle? For regular past tense verbs, it is the ed form. That is, like will become liked, walk will become walked, work will become worked, talk will become talked. So this is, you can say simple past tense also, you can also call it as the past participle. For irregular verbs, then you have to remember them. For example, see, been, seen, had, eaten, shown, written. Okay? So now you usually don't say I had shown or I shown. Okay? You say I had shown, I have shown. Alright? I have written, I have eaten. So these are the past participles. Past participles are usually used with the perfect tenses. So let us look at some examples now of simple past, a verb and its simple past form and its past participle form, and I will highlight the differences to you. So look at the verbs here. Verb is talk, simple past is talked, cry is cried, ring is rang, swim is swam, eat is ate, rise is rose, chase is chased, and go is went. So this is a simple past. Alright, now then what is the past participle? Let us try and understand. See, talk, past participle will still be talked. For cry, the past participle will still be cried. Whereas for ring, the past participle, instead of rang, you will write rung. I will tell you how it is used in different sentences. Swim, simple past is swam. He swam, she swam. Past participle is swam. So when you want to use past participle, when you want to use a sentence in the perfect tense, that time you make use of the past participle. is eaten, rise is risen, chase is chased, and go is gone. Let us look at some examples now. So see, talked, when you use in the simple past, you will say Raj talked to Ram today. Simple past tense. He talked to Ram today. Finished. He has completed the action. When we talk about simple past tense, means the action has been completed, finished and over. Whereas when talked is used as a past participle, see, Raj has talked to Ram about it. So he has talked. There is something which needs to be talked about, and Raj has talked to Ram about it, and let us wait for the outcome. So has talked. There, here the talked is in the past participle because it follows the helping verb has. Let us look at one more example. See, let us take eat and eat. So the dog ate the biscuit. He's finished eating it. He has eaten the biscuit. The dog ate the biscuit. When you want to talk about past participle, you will say the dog has eaten the biscuit. Okay? So these are, you can say, some examples of the verb with the simple past as well as the past participle. So some verbs, some words, they change when they are in the past participle. Alright? So let us look at what all we have learned today. So we talked about the base form. We will pick up two examples and try and see what all we learned today. So base form of love and drink. So these are the base forms. So along with the S, love becomes loves and drink becomes drinks. Okay? In the simple past, love becomes loved and drink becomes drank. It doesn't become drinked. Okay? It is a little irregular here. The present participle, love becomes loving, drink becomes drinking, and the past participle, love becomes loved and drink becomes drunk. Okay? So all these things we talked about in the lesson today. So let us see whether we accomplished what we started doing. So we were looking at verb and its forms. So let us look at a few examples from here before we wind up the lesson for today. So the base form, give. The S form is gives. Past tense is gave. Present participle is giving. And past participle is given. Likewise, we have draw, we have eat, we have shown, take, say, come and go.
So children, now you have watched the video. So after you watch the video now, you will have to complete a few simple tasks. Now you might have watched the video on your computers or your laptops or your mobile phones. Now, after you watch the video, what will you do? You will please go to the description box which is given below the video. So, what is the description box? See, the description box looks like this. Alright? And after you go to the description box, you will see that there are a few questions there. Now, what are these questions about? These questions are about the lesson that we just learned or the video that you just watched. So what will you do? You will think back properly about the lesson and you will try and answer these questions and note down the answers in your notebook if you want. Okay? After that, we have another task waiting. You will also click on the link which you will find in the description box to fill up the Google form. So now, what is the Google form, children? It is nothing but a simple form. There are a few simple questions there about the video which you just saw and also about yourself. So these are the tasks now that you will have to complete after you watch each video.
So children, wasn't that a very interesting lesson? I'm sure you learned a lot of new things in this lesson. If you have liked this video, please hit the like button and also subscribe to my video so that you will get to see all the videos which I keep posting regularly.